Hey, everybody. Jason Carter, Adam Bronson. We got the boys in here, too. How you guys doing?
Not bad.
Good.
Devin Archibald, Wyatt Bowles, Chris Peterson. John's busy putting together the magazine for January.
Who knows what he's doing?
We're taking an hour break.
He's had some things going on. He's cranking hard. John works hours. I don't know. He works midnight to 4 a.m.
He's a night owl.
We're 4 p.m. or 8 p.m.
We're morning dudes, whatever those are called.
Yeah.
Early birds. I don't know. But we just the way
middle Jay birds. Sometimes we're middle birds.
Jason and I, and probably you and Devin and I too, I can get up early and come to work. But when it gets in the winter, 5, 6, I'm done.
Oh,
John comes alive about then till about 3 in the morning and goes to bed. I just don't operate that way.
I was trying to go to bed at 9 last night. And that's pretty regular. Are you guys 9 o'clock yet? Because yeah. You're married, but I don't know if you've actually made the switch to what married dudes do.
Yeah, I'm 9 o'clock-ish, 9:10.
But Devin, but from what you've told us, he's already been on the old man's schedule before marriage, right?
Yeah, I think we both kind of got on it for a little bit when we're in the bachelor pad there.
You know, not a lot going on. I mean, I pile out of bed at 8:30.
Who would tuck who in when you guys were at the bachelor pad? Who went to bed first?
And the winter months are terrible, right? When the daylight saving hits and it's dark at 6, it's bad.
And then you think what you're doing at 8 o'clock in September?
Oh, you're still
it never
it's
gets
not
dark.
Even prime
you're just
yet.
Starting to get glassing, good yeah. glassing light.
It's unbelievable.
And this time of year, 8:30 rolls around, I'm bedding down.
Oh, I'm
9
done.
O'clock.
Tapped out. But we're also coming in early, so. All right. Well, it's that time of year. We did want to do a little
podcast about the theme of the day.
That's right. About a subject that is near and dear to our hearts as we're watching things change. Hold on.
Nice. I don't care.
Archibald's driving down Main right now.
If you find yourself swaying side to side slowly, you're not alone.
Every other 40 to 50-year-old dude's doing the same thing.
Maybe you're the guy that just leaned up and held the walls up at high school dance. You just leaned up against the wall.
That'd be me.
Me too. Guilty.
I was there too.
I'm hitting the KB about right now. Wyatt, he's holding up the parking lot
Shopko
down there.
Shopko parking lot.
Yeah. I'm in an 84 Toyota. What are you in, Wyatt?
Old Power Stroke.
No kidding.
76 CJ7.
Oh, you
different
guys,
generation,
94
Chevy.
You guys were the cool kids. I was in a hatchback.
I did have a 22 250 in the window.
We had a turbo sprint.
Wow. Well, what's this song have to do with hunting, Carter?
Well,
you don't know what until
you... You just don't know what you got till it's gone. You just don't know what you got till it's gone.
All right.
Well, that's what
Let's
it has to do with
goes.
Hunting.
Let's see where this goes. That's right.
We were just talking, Bronson, and of course, Devin and Wyatt, they were around for a lot of this, too. And we were talking the other day about all the different changes we've been seeing since 80s, 90s, 2000s. I mean,
2020.
Yeah.
If you want to talk
even
about
in the last
Idaho
5
General
years.
Going away and
there you go.
Yeah. Arizona trail cameras are looming in the near future, perhaps.
I Nevada mean, just having a change. Trail cam season. There's all kinds of just awesome things that we've seen over the course of time. And then we think about things like that are going on right now. I don't
What's
know.
Next?
What about unlimited sheep in Montana? You know, you things go. Like that.
Wyoming General for the residents of Wyoming. Is that going to be a forever thing?
So I just wanted to, yeah, let's just talk about a few things. Like, you guys remember, I mean, general over-the-counter Utah, because it's our home state.
Yeah, at least Jason and I don't know what it was when you guys started, but when we had dedicated hunter tags before they're dedicated hunter tags, you bought a tag at the grocery store, good statewide. And you could hunt archery if you didn't kill. You could hunt the rifle if you didn't kill. Then the muzzleloader, remember, was late in early November. You got to kill one deer.
Statewide.
Yeah, we didn't have to pick a region until 92, 93, yeah. right? Yeah. 92, 93, they went to the five regions in Utah and went to a draw of roughly 20,000 tags per region, roughly.
And that winter kill of 92, 93 was...
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you know, but just prior to that, it was unbelievable.
Yeah, and, you know, we weren't that... I guess I wasn't that picky, but, I mean, it was just nice that you knew... You could hunt 28-day archery season, a 9-day rifle, and like a 9-day late muzzle. Now those muzzleloader hunts are limited entry hunts in Utah now in all the generals.
Taking 15 points, 16 points
yeah,
on some
those
of them.
Same hunts right now in all the generals. We had them over the counter as part of your general tag. You could do the archery, the rifle, and that hunt.
Yeah. And then there was a time with the dedicated hunter that you, when you drew Pontsagant, you could hunt all three seasons.
Yeah, if you drew the Pontsagant.
Or Henry's.
And it even played to elk, didn't it?
It did, yeah. My dad drew his elk tag in Utah. He was able to hunt archery, rifle, and muzzleloader, but just overlapped the deer seasons.
Yeah, early on it was really weird. When Utah expanded their elk herds and all that, and they were started off with 5 tags, 10 tags here, they didn't have 2 tags for archery, 5 for rifle and 2 for muzzle. It was just rifle tags in the rut. That was the only hunt for years. And so if you wanted to hunt during the archery deer season, because there wasn't an archery elk, you just paid, what, $20?
Yeah.
Something like that.
Minimal fee.
And you get to hunt the archery hunt during the deer hunt because you're out there on the mountain, you got a deer tag. Hunt your elk then, too. If you don't kill, you get the rifle hunt. It was nuts.
It was nuts.
Dedicated hunter elk type tags. You get hunt all seasons. Now that's called a premium or multi-season tag. And they draw 1 or 2 or 3 per unit, yeah. And it's like
20+ points.
20+ on every unit.
But you got to do it. You've got to do it because we keep seeing the quality diminish, and part of that is A tag numbers. But we're good at killing them. We just had a podcast on optics and smart optics and angle range finders and long range rifles and turrets and reticles, and all of these things are attributing to this. Smart trail cameras, cellular trail cameras. You know, all kinds of stuff. People are getting good at killing them, and they're spending time. I don't know if this COVID environment's going what, but people have time. They have time to go out and run their cameras. They have time to scout. There was guys, I talked to a guy about Idaho General deer, and he's like, you know, normally I see like 2 or 3 guys in the field. I saw 25 guys in the field, and he says, I know they didn't give necessarily any more tags. It was just everybody utilized those tags. Everybody went. You know what I mean?
Well, maybe that's what led to some of the changes we're talking about now. Now you've got non-resident sub-quotas within the greater total non-resident, you know, general tag that used to be done statewide except for limited entry units until this year. And that's gone. It's probably not going to come back.
No.
And it's got people gnashing teeth pretty hard.
So what about, like, there was over-the-counter Arizona Strip archery tags, 13A.
Until 2007. We're not
that
talking
still
that
haunts you?
Yeah, I remember when I found, I didn't even know that.
Well, the Kaibab,
but in 2007, yeah. I was 18.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Well, that's not
later,
that long
draw.
Ago.
No.
When the Kaibab and 13A, 13B wasn't, but 13A.
Right, 13A.
And the Kaibab, you could every year, $125 non-permit tag or whatever they're called, just like the ones they sell now, you still hunt all of the central and southern Arizona. It's the same, just the same general deer tag, non-permit deer tag, and you can hunt up there in August over the counter.
Well, and Clint and I went out there in his rotten old Chevy, 92 Chevy. You remember, you know, those hinged pins that go down through the door jams, and I mean, those are rotten and falling out, and they all need new bushings. Even the new ones needed new bushings. And anyway, we went out there and tried to do our best at it. Of course, back then, archery equipment was whatever you could find, and we're broke. And I mean, you didn't value it. Like if you would have said, hey, this tag here takes 20 points, you would have valued it. You would have put everything into it. But when you can get it every year, let's just go do a smash and grab for
3-day
weekend.
Go for the weekend.
Yeah.
I think that's the whole thing why we're even talking about this in a podcast, because you're right. And to a large extent, look at the Utah General now. After 25 years, we'll just say it, of draw, you went to a subunit thing maybe 10 years ago where it's unit by unit. But it takes points now. You don't get one every year for the most part. And if you really value that, which a lot of people do, they put a lot more time into that. They do. And the guys that really treat it like a good tag, they've killed some great bucks. There's something to be had for them, but when you could buy it at Walmart and hunt for a dedicated hunter, we talk about this about the dedicated hunter program. It sometimes occurs because I got 60 days to hunt. You know, I'm not going to get that serious. But when you got it, when you draw a 5-day rifle hunt or a 9-day rifle hunt, and that's all you got, it's like you got tunnel vision a little bit.
And you're
not
going to get it for the next 2 years, most likely. Yeah. You're going to hunt every single day.
Well, there was a tag, and I remember it vividly. There was a 241 landowner tag come up for sale, and nobody knew anything about it. It sold for like $3,200. And nobody I knew wanted it 15 years ago, maybe roughly. Yeah,
more,
oh yeah.
I don't know.
No, I mean, early 2000s. Now, that's more valuable than a 242 tag, really. I mean, a 241 only tags 27.5, you know. So it's just, I'm just saying.
And back then there was real deer.
We're not fighting for 200s. There's real deer.
And in the 240s, you could hunt till mid to late November on the rifle.
Well, oh.
The season dates.
I can't stand to think about the season dates. I can't stand it. Can you think about it? Oh. They used to let you hunt Thanksgiving and in Utah, Nevada, lots of places. And you're just like, man, now we're cutting them off in October. October 31st is when it ends. You know what I mean? And they're just starting to rut a little bit. It's just crazy to think about some of the change we've seen, not only dollar-wise, but, Jen, not only are these tags selling for $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, Poncegon tags, $30,000, $40,000+.
Which also has a neighboring General Deer unit that –
that's off the charts,
good.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Well, just look at Boulder, Panguitch, Zion, all three sides of the ponds. I mean, kill a lot of pretty good deer on them every year. I mean, there's a lot of hunters. We don't want to minimize that. They're still general season units. You see a lot of people. But big deer to be had on those three.
For Archibald took down his Poncegon Legend.
Oh, yeah.
What story?
He walked a little too far, I guess.
Well, yeah,
like
Poncegon buck that migrates to Zion, you know, and got smoked.
And I'll bet you when
this?
I shot
buck
that
is
buck,
this?
That it's buck one in my off? Office.
Yeah. Oh, that one in there?
6x6, yep.
No kidding. What did that thing go?
Like 203, just over 2.
Dump that deer.
I'll bet I could have counted 20 people from where I shot him. Stand up, look around, you could see 20 people, easy. Like
really?
Way out there, you know, but yeah, I mean, orange everywhere.
Was this back in the day of the 10x50 red fields?
This isn't that long ago.
2017.
I didn't know that. You killed that buck that recently?
Yeah.
Dude, I learned everything from a podcast.
The guys had hunted him on the archery hunt for
in the ponds, right?
Years.
Multiple
he took an arrow the year I killed him and the year before.
Oh, no kidding.
In his back straps, yeah.
No kidding. How did you know? Was there scarring?
I had no idea.
Or
I
well,
killed
they
him
came to you and said, hey,
yeah,
I got an
I killed
arrow
him
in that deer.
And I think it was Cameron or you, Wyatt, told me, hey,
somebody
that buck's
contacted you.
Seen it, we'd seen forever. It in the summertime. It was pretty popular deer. A lot of people had been hunting it and chasing it around.
And so as soon as he shot it, did you know immediately, pretty much?
Yeah, as soon as we got the picture sent over to us, yeah. Wow.
I, come to find out, had liked the photo of the deer on Instagram.
The velvet?
A year before, had no idea I killed him the next year.
Yeah. Really?
Wow.
Just a couple of the photographers over there were taking some really good shots of him.
Yeah. Well, I mean, we're talking 50, 60 miles, so.
Mm, that's cool.
That's kind of neat.
Awesome story.
That is awesome. So let's tell us about the kill scene.
There I was, crosshairs with orange and every portion of my reticle.
You talk about angle. I had a 26 degree angle down.
No kidding.
And I had the GeoVids and just boom, 500, and I dialed to like 420, 440.
Yeah.
That
was it.
But that was it.
No problem.
No problem.
You didn't have to have a foot race there. Somebody else tagging him.
Nobody else shot.
Nope. Just glassed him up. And I actually filmed it. I hit record because I was alone. I wanted to know where I hit and everything. And it was like 2.5 minutes before I shot, getting ready, dialing, you know, all that.
Was he bedded or moving?
No, just feeding.
Oh, wow.
Just hiding by himself.
You remember when Poncegon landowner tags
grand.
Were 5 to 7?
That was early 2000s because I was a biologist there and I was dealing with them on a daily basis. And we went through a process between 2003 and 5 of cutting tags.
Yeah.
And it was a bloodbath.
Yeah.
I mean, it was.
Between the locals, landowners.
Well, just landowner. You're talking about going from 40.
There was
40,
posted
40,
hunting units that are now CWMUs.
Yep, CWMU and landowner association was getting 30 to 40 tags. And we'd cut the public tags in half. You know, there's a group called the Friends of the Poncegon that formed, and they were just very adamant. We just we're killing too many deer. We want to issue less tax. Well, when you cut the public draw tax, the landowner tags are a year behind in the permit setting cycle. So then when you start going through that, boy, I mean, you're talking $5,000 or $6,000 a tag at times, you know, 40.
Well, Lyle, my cousin buy one every single year. Okay. He had muzzleloader rut hunt.
Yeah, well, I was going to say, that's another thing that's gone.
That's when the muzzleloader was.
Muzzleloader rut hunt.
It was unbelievable.
That would be
fun.
It
was the first week or sometimes 10 days where the calendar went. This is, say, October 30th, 31st to November 7th to 10th, you know.
It's unbelievable.
And so, yeah, we went through that, cutting tags, and then it wasn't long that it's just supply and demand. Once the tags got cut in half, and over the next handful of years, quality did start to improve, and it wasn't long that those tags had doubled and tripled in price and quadrupled, and now they're almost 10 times. If, like I said, we're talking $40,000 Ponsonagat tags. I mean, there's 20-ish, 20 to 30, counting
but
the conservation
tags. But,
Adam,
the cost of living goes up 3% a year.
But that's only been 15 years that we're talking
about.
Nothing
can catch a Ponsonagat. The price increase of what big deer bring,
nothing.
That's so exponential. Well, I just think there's been a lot of that kind of stuff that we've watched come and go, and we know. I used to have a good friend tell me, he says, the best tag you ever have in your life comes into your mailbox every year, and he was talking about Utah General.
Yeah, but we've had lifetime licenses. So you get to pick whatever you want. Yeah.
Back in the day when they basically were coming in your mailbox, you know.
Well, I just remember I wasn't living in Utah then. I was in on a LDS mission. My dad wrote me a letter, and it's like a week or 10-day lag getting the letter, and then a week or 10-day lag getting it back. And he wrote me and says, hey, they're going to stop selling Utah lifetime licenses. Do you want me to take some money out of your savings and buy it? And they're $500.
Yeah, they're $500.
Okay. And I just remember, it was like I got it, and it was like in 4 days it was going to be over. And I'm like, I hope he does it, because I can't write him a letter and get it back. There's no pick up the phone. There's no Skype. There's no text. There's no nothing. This is early 90s, and thankfully he did it, because I got home and I had a lifetime license for
me
and
Aaron. He's like, son, you owe me $500, and then there was a little interest accruing while you were gone.
I don't know, but I mean, at the time, it just it was a kind of a big decision. I mean, $500,
huge.
And you could buy, a deer tag was probably $15. I don't remember
if you remember, back then, the reason to buy it was a cost savings over your life.
That was all you evaluated.
Nobody ever thought that general tags would go away.
No.
So do I buy a lifetime? Well, they're not ever going to go away.
They're only $15 or $20,
and they're
bucks.
Never
going to
go
take
away.
20
look
something
at,
years.
Look at the cost of Idaho tags. That guys like my dad regrets not buying a lifetime license.
Yes.
A long time ago.
Yeah, but just in price alone. But someday those are all going away. Well, what do you do with the lifetime? Well, you give them their choice for the rest of their life, and that's what they're doing.
Oh, it's invaluable. Times change, and you got to take advantage of what's in front of you and what's right on the plate. Eat what's in front of you.
How about
just put something good in front of me.
Another one I thought of is, like, when I was a kid, we would go to Walmart, hop in the truck, and go.
We did that on the LaSalle.
Because it's private property, and now it's CWMU's and guys in.
CWMU's, the LaSalle's.
Hunting private ground, period, all over the West. Now they're leased, they're different units, it's gone.
I know.
I scared a lot of bulls on the LaSalle's. Offhand, I'd just see him and just pull up offhand.
Same
shooting.
Here.
I mean,
okay, so LaSalle's
I mean,
near,
they were
near and dear to my heart.
This big. I mean, any bull was good. I remember my dad shot some spikes. He shot a 5-point 1 year, probably a 3-year-old, maybe 4, but a nice 5. But Aaron and I had it mounted in our bedroom, and my whole life we looked at that. It's like it was so
dude, sometimes
big.
A 5x6 won the big bull contest in Moab.
Yes.
I mean, that's what happened.
Yeah.
Those were back in the human trail camera days. I was a human trail camera.
Yeah.
And I sat in a lot of aspen trees. And do you remember speaking of which, harnesses have come a long ways, too. We had an inch and a half strap, sometimes just a white little rope around your waist.
If you fell, you
turn
upside down.
You're swinging in those aspens. You're swinging in them. I mean, geez. And so, I spent a lot of time in a tree stand. A lot of time.
But yeah, that's right, Archibald.
Logging game.
You know, now Utah went through a pretty hotly contested, I don't know what you'd call it, public process. They're, we've capped the general tags. I can't remember, 15,000, 20,000 in Utah for any bull. And the division was going to add a few more any bull units where there's not really that many elk, and they were proposing going to unlimited. And the public shot it down. They wanted to keep the quota in place. And we went from the days where Boulder. Boulder used to be a general.
Oh, yeah.
Boulder used to be a general. So did LaSalle's. I don't know all of them.
Dude,
I was
It was like we hung San Juan, Pavant, and Southwest Desert were kind of
yeah,
your three.
San Juan had Newly Elk in the 1987-88. They turned them loose from Harder Ranch. So it was never anything but a limited entry. But there's a lot of our limited entry units in Utah. I would imagine like Fish Lake and Mantide. I know Dutton was. Dutton was the general season bull. And there wasn't big bulls like we think.
No, it's
not.
Nice.
It's just elk.
Right. But back then you could get an elk tag. Now it's pretty hard. Elk tags are few and far between.
Utah's
you
gone
can
the
general.
Opposite direction. That's it's right. a quality. They have some general season
stuff. And it is nice
stuff.
To have some quality stuff here and there. Yeah. It is. I got one for you. So how about Colorado in the 90s?
Oh, yeah.
Was over-the-counter deer hunts, over-the-counter on the west side, and see, the only thing anybody ever talked about was Eastern Plains. The only thing.
Because it was over-the-counter. When you statewide, probably west of I-25 was probably the line, because that's kind of the line now on the season structure stuff.
Right.
But you grew up in Moab. You're 20 miles from Colorado as a crow flies, an hour to drive. I'm 15 or 20. And I had some friends that lived over or had property over there. Groundhog and all that, you know, 7-1, 7-11, and we would hunt bulls over there over the counter on their property.
Oh yeah,
like junior, senior high school would go over there, wake up, smash over there, load up two or three bulls in one morning and drive home like it was nothing. Like,
oh, yeah.
But it was that was where I killed my first elk. They're just rag fives, but it was awesome. Didn't even ever think of buying a deer tag. I could have bought one over the counter because deer were what we had in Utah. It goes back to this. I have a lot of deer in Utah. Why would I go to Colorado and shoot a deer? I got good bucks on the San Juan right here.
No,
I don't have
license fees, $43.
Yeah, but
why
I
would I do
I
that?
I can't shoot an elk. I got big bulls they turned loose 8 years ago, still on. I'm going to shoot anything I see over there. And now look at how that's turned. We're fighting to go to Colorado revolves. How many people's plans revolve around Colorado deer every year?
And they did bring the deer back. When they limited it, they did bring the deer back. It was crazy. And back then in 1996, it was an extreme drought. And I remember drawing unit 142 out on the Eastern Plains. It was a public land Eastern Plains hunt, and it still is to this day. But it was one of the very few places that you could go that had big deer. And so you'd go out there and hunt an army base, Pinyon Canyon. Army base with they told you where to camp and all of these kind of restrictions. And anyway,
nobody even applied for color. There wasn't enough places to intrigue you to apply for Pinyon Canyon, a couple of those, but I mean you did.
Yeah.
You and your dad were doing that probably before
we did that,
but very many people.
Oh yeah,
but it wasn't until the late 90s
but
early
you wouldn't
2000s
stop. You wouldn't stop. You would hit I-70. You would never stop.
No.
For deer until you got to Denver. I mean, you're not stopping.
No.
Or, you know, we went up through Trinidad. There's a whole long story behind that trip.
Is that the one that was blizzard? And they put the gates down and you drove around them? On the freeway, they're closing the freeways down. You had an old rancher.
Well, it was an old rancher. He's like, I'll go if you go, pard. And I'm like, let's go. But and everybody, they had the schools open and everybody was, you know, getting off of 25 and going into these small little communities and shacking up in the gyms. I mean, because it was such a giant snowstorm.
Blizzard, yeah.
But no, this is back when I had an old 89 Chev that was wore out before I even got it. And I changed the ball joints in the parking lot in Trinidad. Broken glass everywhere and I'm under there just cranking it. I mean, guys like, we can't. I ate a tire up just getting there just because everything was so loose. So and they couldn't
kick you out.
No,
you
freaking get align them. They couldn't align them.
No, not with ball joints.
No, not with everything. So anyway, I replaced some parts and an alternator went out and I was out in the hills and had to go get an alternator and replace it in the hills. Yeah, it was just one of those college kid days where I had, you know, wasted 14, 15 points on a Wazoo unit and seen a 210 incher and never got it killed because I was a kid, you know. Big old inline. I can still see the deer. So anyway, lots of change. Just crazy amount of change. And so everybody, we're seeing more non-resident limitations on stuff in Wyoming, you know, G and H, and they want more quality. And so they keep cutting non-resident tags and trying to continue to let residents hunt over the counter. And that's going to end too, residents. That's going to end.
And I mean, we're not anti Wyoming residents. We're just bringing it up as a – that's one of the last holdouts. I mean, they're in Idaho.
Yeah.
Idaho made the step this year to make the non-residents go to a draw, sub-quarter so draw, we'll call it. I mean, and it's
a smashing grab
never
December
go
1.
It just won't.
And everybody jumps in and
buys what they think
might
the
as well be
units.
A draw. Might as yeah. well be a draw.
And, you know, you got – remember back in the – well, it was – there's still this, some of this stuff isn't very long ago. The early 2000s, mid 2002 to 5 or 6, that AR 301 in Utah.
Oh, yeah.
They called, well, how many is like 15 or 20 yes. limited entry units?
Yes. And there wasn't points associated with it, so if you chose to do that, you didn't get elk points.
Yeah, like in Utah's residents, we always we still have to choose between deer or elk or antelope. You got to choose one species. But if you were, so I was locked into my elk chase. You were probably
yeah.
at the time.
Oh, yeah.
Because you were a couple years ahead of me. You burned yeah. yours. So you're if you did limited entry elk, you couldn't put in for AR 301. But guys that were applying for deer could just crush the AR 301 every year. That was yeah. an elk act.
Yep.
And no points. And you could hunt the archery season and hunt 15 or 20, the Boulder, Dutton, all these units.
They were halfway decent, even they though they weren't managed like they are now. They were yeah. still halfway
hadn't
decent.
Hadn't had quite enough time since the Any Bull days to really get giant bulls, but they were right. They were starting.
What years was that?
Early 2000s.
I think I still got regulations from
not
those
that
days.
Much
I want to say 2 to 5.
Earlier than the glory days for elk in Utah, really.
No, right after that ended. Right yeah. after that ended, and they kind of started doing the drawing the tag, and then they added archery only on a unit, and that's when it peaked.
What I think's crazy is when you go through these times, like, say, the amazing times in Utah for elk, did you ever think they'd end?
No.
Ever?
Passing 380
2004, goals. 5, 6, 7, did you ever think, I mean... Wow, we're rewriting
the record
book. We
got so
book.
Numb, like a 370 or 80 bull.
That's
just
how we
like, can't, oh, that's all
we
they
can't
killed?
Even get Wyatt off center because he's put his hands on so many
oh,
clients,
I
giants.
And
Wyatt,
now
it, tell us about
and
it.
And now he's a Boone and Crockett scorer, so he still gets to glean the best of the best. Every year he gets to hold them from Utah and
so
neighboring
he's like,
states.
Why would I want to go to Nevada? They only have 380 bulls.
Yeah, no, it's not like that huh? at all. 380 is always a giant bull, but the Utah was, we were spoiled here for a while. I mean, it was producing double-digit 400-plus inch bulls a year, and now it seems like if we see
one, two,
yeah, two, three, four a year, it's a great year.
Well, and it was a great year at 3 and 4.
Yeah,
well, it is
mm-hmm.
this year. There great,
was,
right?
There was times they would kill 600-700 plus on one unit.
Yeah,
yeah,
exactly. Just line up
nuts. Pavon,
and you're hunting 400 bulls, and just everything else is 390, 380, whatever. It was awesome. Well,
so
Alaska,
that's what
I
we've
guess.
Seen with Colorado. When mid 2000s, we're over there hunting Colorado. It's unbelievable. You think those days will never end. Now we're looking at late season dates with coming on the heels of some of the couple of the worst seasons we've ever seen, and no tag numbers change other than maybe even increasing tags because they're afraid of CWD. And so they're increasing tags to even knock the age down a little
okay.
bit more.
Perfect example. Did
and
we
now
think
late
in,
season dates.
When Colorado went to a draw late 90s, by 2003 or 4, 2004 was my first year hunting, maybe
yeah.
about you,
yeah.
3 or 4.
Yeah.
And we thought, what? Where has this been? Why have I not
right.
heard of this?
Right.
It was the first year I went there. It was a giant snow year. Remember that October year, 2004? I mean, it dumped 3-4 feet here in Utah.
Yeah, I remember pounded that. This. Yeah.
Unbelievable. And I get over there, and I'm hunting 43, and it has 14ers all over the place. Well, the deer, they can't.
14ers mean them 14,000-foot
yes.
peaks.
And I've never seen anything to this day, a deer hunt like that.
And you killed?
Yeah, I killed a 33-inch, 200-inch-plus buck.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
I mean, but I saw deer as good or bigger. I mean, I did. Some of them were in the fields already because there's no place. There was just snow everywhere. And you just thought, this is gonna change my life. I remember I was 30 years old. I was 30 years old that year, roughly.
No
shit. I was almost 31. I stayed there. I remember I killed my first 30-inch buck when I was 30. That sticks in my mind. And you know, that just does. But the next year, the season dates kicked a week later, and I remember, and we were drawing tags, but those tags are second choice. Remember the landowner tags? What were they, two to three, 400 bucks?
Oh, yeah. We'd have stacks of landowner tags. Like, literally, that deep because you could transfer them back then.
They
like
could,
they would just
they could apply for leftovers and get a pile of them.
Yeah, we
they
had,
were cheap.
We had a lot of clients that wanted tags, and
the next year we drew it as a leftover again, and went there with the dates ratcheted 6 days later, like it does in Colorado. We thought this and it. We hunted 7 days, the last seven, and I shot like a 25 or 6-inch heavy tall 4x3, and that was the only buck we saw. Warm, hot, dry the whole time. And that's when I realized. Dates don't mean everything in Colorado. The weather trumps dates.
Yeah,
but then to fast forward it all till 2020, we're talking about. I mean, that's why everybody got into a frenzy, and a lot of people started putting in for Colorado heavy at that point, and have drawn, and maybe trying to go back. It's just not the same in 2020. It's not as ripe.
Well, and now we're given more and more tags, later yes. season dates. Why don't we just go over the counter, crash it again? And then we'll recycle it, and then that cycle will come back. I mean, really, I'm telling you, Game and Fish does not care about quality, and that's why you've got these little localized deer groups like Gunnison Basin and whatnot that fight so hard because they know what it once was. They know what it could be.
And not 50s and 60s. We're talking 2000s. I mean, you had some winners mixed in there, but there's always going to be heavy winners, and there's going to be opportunities to rebound from those. But – yeah, I mean, it's
go over the counter. Just do over the counter Colorado. Get it over with.
Purge everybody's
Seriously.
Points and start, we'll
purge
start over
the deer
at zero.
Herd. Purge the deer yeah. herd. People get
Mine
ticked
are zero
enough.
Anyway.
Same
so
here.
People get ticked enough that they'll make them change. They'll make them change. We got wolves coming and everything else going on. Just purge it, crash it, and then everybody is up in arms, even the opportunists, the people that aren't trophy hunters. They'll get on our side too, and we'll make a change. That's what I think. That's what needs to happen. Let's push for it. So anyway, there's just it's crazy to watch it. So sometimes we're talking about year to year there's not much change. There's always change happening, and then all of a sudden you wake up and you're like, wow, where'd those days go?
Archery deer in Arizona. We think right now they'll never get away with that. Isn't that if you were all answer
you mean
that
over
right
the
now,
counter
over
tags,
the counter
the
over yeah. the archery. Counter. If you'd ask me now, I'm like, yeah, there's enough places to roam. I can't see that going away. Who knows? Nothing is safe.
And there's some amazing hunting. There's coos deer guys that live for that hunt. They're rutting.
And I can see. You just can't see how that would happen. But we said the same thing about our deer in the 90s, that we're never going to have to draw. A $500 lifetime license is a borderline, whether that's worth it or not in your lifetime. We thought that. So you just don't know what's in front of you that you better be taking more advantage of.
Well,
How
about working out in a gym? We got a gym owner. There's a gym owner getting a $1.2 million fine for keeping his doors open.
The news said the governor's name at lunch. We didn't know that governor's name, so it wasn't.
Yeah, $1.2 million
refused
fine.
Refused to mask up or make his
it's right
patrons
here.
Mask up.
$1.2 million fines for defying Governor Murphy's coronavirus lockdown orders. Chris, you might look up Murphy. Governor Murphy. Where is he from? I'm just telling you.
How does that apply
you
to
never,
Jones?
Here's my point. Your freedoms get stripped from you. You don't even know. You wake up one day and you can't go buy groceries without a mask on. You can't. And I'm not saying it's good, bad, or in between. I'm just saying. You just don't know the stuff you take for granted. Going out to eat at a restaurant for heck's sake.
How about this? Back in when I was in school, and I still like to do it. Shed hunting.
Now you got to take a course, like, online course. You got seasons.
I can't even go to Nevada.
Let's list the states. Yeah, what
and
states?
And I'm scared of snakes.
Utah,
so at that point, I'm
Nevada.
Done.
Nevada, Colorado, Wyoming. I don't know about Idaho, but those three: Nevada, Colorado, Wyoming. At least.
Well, and Utah was doing a
Utah for some years, in the heavy years.
That's right. Again,
we had the director on to talk about that because
we're
it was
our
like,
own worst enemy because people are driving cross country and harassing wildlife or whatever.
When it was deep snow, but I mean,
but would you ever guess?
Good example,
that they would
Archibald.
Go to that?
Yeah, I got to make sure when every year my boy takes that class. Like, you got to have that certificate with you.
Yeah,
you're going out
then,
with your buddies.
And then when it opens, everybody goes because it's the opener and you have
it's
limited
legal.
Time instead of just wide open whatever.
Good example, shed hunting.
Yeah,
I mean, 20 years ago, if you told me you're going to have to. Okay, you got to get draw permits to hunt Antelope Island for sheds.
I remember, use permits, Forest Service and BLM permits, Bronson. I mean, there was people in the 90s. There wasn't such a thing, really. Huh?
No. No.
There might have been, but nobody. It wasn't a thing. It wasn't a thing.
Yeah, now you got guide license, special use permits in 14 different jurisdictions. And
so anyway.
Good example, Archibald. The shed hang was spot on. You can't just wake up and say, I'm going to go shed hunting today. You
I would
read.
Have graduated college like 5 years earlier if they would have done that a couple years.
You say you might have made something yourself. Well, we're happy to have
Wyatt
you here,
knows.
Archibald.
Wyatt knows.
Instead, you had a pile of sheds.
Yeah. Most of them are gone now in China or somewhere.
Dog.
No.
They made a lot of people feel
China.
Really
Chinaman,
good.
I don't
Who
know.
Knows where they're at now.
I yeah. don't know.
That was New Jersey.
Was what? It New Jersey?
Really?
Poor guy. We should set up a GoFundMe account. I'm sure he's already got 14 of them set up. Hopefully he does. But crazy.
I got one I remember. Mm-hmm. 2007, I drew second choice, a 44 private land only deer tag.
There you go.
Did John draw that too?
Yeah.
John both
and
of
I
you.
Both.
Is that the buck in his office?
Uh-huh.
Huh?
That yep,
big
the
191 incher?
Yep.
Second choice.
Second choice. Yep.
I don't know what to say. It's that kind of scenario, though, has happened recently, Bronson, the last 5 years
well,
in Colorado.
Well, you just said 2007, and we're yeah. talking about 13 years ago. You could hunt 13A and the Kaibab every year over the counter. That's not – this isn't – we're talking about our grandpas.
Yeah.
I missed the biggest buck I've ever shot out in 07 in Colorado.
Did you?
Never forget it.
07.
No way.
07.
That was the year we killed Chief.
0 point unit. I drew it 2 years in a row.
What unit was it?
33.
Yeah. Oh yeah. There's good potential there, but man, what a grinder. Well,
yep. But wow. I'm telling you, I saw bucks. It was awesome.
It was right. So right.
Did you ever go back?
That's when I killed that.
You've never been back?
I haven't been back.
Yeah, it's not that good.
Started hunting elk in November.
Guiding out them dang elk getting away. Deer.
How about back when you could apply in Nevada's guide draw and in the regular draw for deer, get 2 points, go in both draws.
I would do it every year.
Get 2 points.
I would do it. I was, just to
I did
get
too.
Because what you really wanted, you put in for the good units and the guide draw, you got your point a month early, so you had your point extra point squared for the regular draw.
Wow,
that's like 10 years ago.
And you could get 2 points a year in the early parts of that.
Yeah, and then they did away with the 2 points, but you could do the guide draw, get your points, so it added to your total to be squared for the regular draw. It's a fact. It's like 10 years ago. We're not talking about stuff 30 years ago.
No,
we did. I did it.
Now you can't hang a camera on a tree after July 31st,
or walk around between the months of whatever.
Oh, and pick up an old white bone. It's not attached to a skull.
From January 1 to May 1, Utards are not allowed there.
Oh, anyway.
And then you get trail cameras for 2 months, and then we're not allowed there for a little bit again. It's just
the restrictions.
We're not picking on
the
Nevada.
Heavily,
we're just pointing everything out.
No, and the most heavily restricted professional sport or sport there is hunting. Think about it. I mean, start, stop. All beginning to the end, daily hours. Daily hours depending on the day of the month. The day of the year, whatever, down to the caliber. I mean, you can't even use a 45 caliber muzzleloader in Colorado for elk or something. But those, you put a 400 grain bullet, you can't tell me that's not going to hurt something. You know what I mean? Tell me I'm wrong.
I wouldn't want to be in front of that.
I'm just saying, there's lots of crazy stuff going on. Lots of stuff that we've seen.
What's next? You just got to be. And it doesn't need to be a complete opportunity like an Idaho General, like an over-the-counter archery deer in Arizona that we're thinking of. It can just be your backyard elk general elk unit that you got in your state right now that's like, I'm killing some good bulls. You ride the wave before it crests and you got flat water.
Take advantage, full advantage of what you got for sure.
I don't know.
Buy $25,000 tags because next year they might be $35,000. I don't know. Is that what you guys are talking about?
Buy $25 tags to next year, they might be $50.
Or they might not be available at all.
I just sat here and thought
like
about if they took something away that I'd be mad I didn't take advantage of, what? Like Arizona hunter safety extra point.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
There you go.
If they took that away tomorrow, I'd be so mad.
Well, and this year, I've talked to a lot of people that are wondering what they're doing. I'm like, I don't know. Good luck getting a good answer because they're not having in-person stuff. And so temporarily been off limits for the last probably year.
I don't know. I went down with my whole family and did the course with my whole family. Called it a family vacation. Two days. Told Jana we were going to Arizona. She was excited. We pull up to the Hunter Education Building.
In Kingman. Beautiful Kingman.
Sandwiches on the tailgate, babe.
It's kind of like me when I took the family vacation. First time I ever been to Hawaii. Went to Hawaii. Toting guns.
That's hilarious. Over there. That's hilarious, too.
And nobody, I didn't tell any. Becky knew, of course. The kids knew, and it was for the kids, right?
Yeah.
For the kids.
Yeah.
After the first 2 days there, I sent pictures to my parents of some dead axis deer. And they're like, only you can get away with that. Go to Hawaii with your family and
sounds like Wyatt Sunday drives, sneaking a pair of tens in there.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But if the spotting scope goes in there, it's going to tip her off that it's not just a Sunday drive. I'm scouting.
Yeah, exactly. So you can slip the pair of tens in there and maybe get away with it. But if you put the spotting scope, everything else in there, it's a deer spotting trip.
She looks at you, just say, you know, sometimes the sunsets are neat to look through binoculars.
You never know.
Never know what you're going to see.
Yeah.
Never know when you need them. Did you ever go back and video that deer?
I've been at the office daylight till dark.
Oh, I know.
You're not even going to go video a 200
I'll get back out.
Give me
there.
An Onyx pin.
I'll get back out.
Hey,
there.
I work here too. I can figure out how to video that thing.
we haven't been here out of the daylight either.
No, but lunch. So. We get a lunch hour. We might have to forego a
I don't think
bad sushi trip. I don't know.
yeah.
All right. Well, lots of things changing. I don't know. It's one of those crazy things. I just think you guys need to take advantage of stuff while you can, because all of this stuff is going to change, and you're going to look back on opportunities that you have now. Dedicated hunter might go away. I don't know. That allows us to hunt all three seasons. How excited are we about that?
Yeah.
And then what if that went away? That would suck, right? The ability to hunt all seasons in Nevada on landowner tags, that would suck for deer. And so, you know, you can hunt multiple deer. You can kill one with a landowner tag, a draw tag, a whatever. So there's just things that we do still take for granted, even though things change for the worse. And we've seen a lot of change over the last
exactly. And the budget-oriented guys, you know, it's mostly the cost that has changed in multiple states.
Just that alone.
Yeah.
Look at Idaho this year.
Yeah.
I mean, bumping the deer tag price, bumping the non-resident license to, 185? You know, application fees for the big three are like 45 plus convenience fees on top of that at 2,600. Mm-hmm. You're at 300 something bucks.
Yeah, you were adding it up. 300 something non-refundable.
To put in for moose sheep and goat as a non-resident. And I know everybody there, wow, don't apply then. I'm just pointing out nothing stays the same. And when you're.
And you might not apply.
Yeah.
And you might not apply. No. Now that we're not necessarily getting a general.
I bought a 3-year license, so I'm committed for 3 years. Because I saw that coming to an end.
But that you do a 3-year license now, you're just back into the normal rate. So Bronson did it just 1 year prior.
You brought up earlier the Wyoming sheep, the climb.
No, the $7 point days. And or just if you'd have just had the foresight, and I realize part of it is you got to be old enough and aware enough and in the application game to know they're starting a point system. But that's one Carter and I kick ourselves about.
Well, yeah.
I mean, we didn't get on the ground floor. And so when they started going to $75, it was like, I don't think I'm going to get it. I still wish I would have kept, because I think I could have a tag by now.
Yeah.
Probably not.
It cost me a sheep doing just, you know, there's a couple regrets. We all have a few regrets, and we should have a podcast on that. But though, that's one of mine.
What song would we have maybe for regrets?
I don't know. We'll have to think.
Chris? No. You're good at those. You're the you have good jingles on our Instagram about tying a nice song to go with something.
We could probably get a Ray Wiley Hubbard song.
A little Cinderella today kind of applied, but, you know, we get something that regrets. I don't know,
but let's leave you on another little note. Here we go, Devin. You going to sway?
I don't think so.
No?
Maybe. Give it 30 more seconds.
Yeah.
Don't know what you got till it's gone, boys.
Might have been a good podcast to call up some old-timers. You know, cold call.
Yeah, a little poorly lit high school cafeteria dance hall right here.
Even the next generation above you two.
Older than us?
Oh, yeah. Like
are those guys still alive?
Yeah, there's got to be one or two kicking around somewhere.
I'd have to tell my dad what the podcast was before I cold called him on the podcast.
What's a podcast, Adam?
Yeah, just talk to me, Dad. Just talk. I'll tell you later.
Some things you just don't want to change.
But it's coming.
Right, Chris?
That's right.
That's enough. Let's go to work.